Hi, Dorothy.
There's a certain thing that causes them
too much in the opposite direction. Like add some curves and some edges. Add some edges to sort of bring it back. Kind of like, you know how we, you know, to find the perfect body alignment, we do the duck.
Yeah.
And you swivel back and forth until you find the middle.
Right.
Like something like that would be like H's, swing until you find the right onset. So maybe onset exercises? Because it probably begins with the onset. If you start pressed, you're going to be pressed. And it's harder to change after you start pressed. So
but
if you change your starting,
right,
then maybe you have a better chance of maintaining and not pressing.
Yeah. But if there's too much breath pressure,
maybe something that moves. It's hard. For me, it's hard to press when I'm
right.
Doing like a run, you know what I mean?
True.
Because it's just going so fast.
Right.
The
yeah.
I don't think fast. I should just have to do what we might not want to go up. Should be pushing. That way she's not thinking about forcing it in formation, which I'm not trying to do.
Right.
All right, so let's wrap it up and we'll reconvene. Okay, so, Team Sarah. Female student with delayed onset of sound of words with initial vowels. Kind of threw you guys for a curve, but we'll talk about that in a minute. So what'd you guys come up with?
Breath or making sure that not collapsing get that initial pressure started.
Okay.
So maybe foot drills, maybe like something that's like short and supply.
Right, what did you note about the, when I threw you the curve about, what about, that could be a warning sign. A delayed onset with vowels can be a warning sign of, well, that you have something on the vocal fold margin. And, you know, then if that's keeping them from, you know, so they're getting kind of a little gap instead of nice, you know, they're getting this kind of a closure. And so the other part of this is, sounds breathy unless they're singing loud. That's a big whoa, you know. If you have the delayed onset and it's breathy unless they sing loud, that's a pretty good sign that there is some kind of swelling or something going on there that certainly needs addressing, probably with the guidance of a physician to check it out. So let's say that there isn't something pathological, you're just hearing, they have a hard time kind of getting that onset on words that start with vowel. Well, yeah, a nasal, you know, a ma, na, as I've said before, ng, I'm not a huge fan of because of what it does with your tongue. If you're going to do a nasal, I think N is probably the best one since it gets your tongue forward as well. Na, na, or voiced consonants, particularly like voiced, yeah, and maybe even voiced plosives. The look of delight on his face when he managed, it was like, oh. just able to initiate efficiently without it, you know.
You could also maybe have them hold their hand.
That's a possibility,
do
yeah.
Do you feel that poof of air?
Yeah.
Before you begin?
And you might also do some speaking to singing kinds of things, like do you notice it in their speech or is it only when they sing? But yeah, if you're hearing a delayed onset pretty consistently, and you're hearing it in their speech as well as their singing, you know, that's when you start asking questions. You know, is this something? You know, how are you feeling today? Is this? Has your voice been kind of doing like this for the last little while?
Did you overuse it this weekend?
Did you overuse it? Right? Are you just laminopropria swelling, and you can do some of those tests, you know, the very soft, you know, the really soft glide on an E, and like little staccati, very soft, and happy birthday to you, very, very low volume. If you're hearing a little cutting out on things like that, that's a sign they've got at least some swelling going on. And if it doesn't resolve pretty quickly, that's, you know, like they come in 2 or 3 days later, that's the kind where you said, let's not have a lesson today, let's get you a little rested, and maybe we try, you know, on Wednesday. And then if they come in Wednesday and it's still the same, you go, you know, I just want to be safe. Let's, you know, err on the side of caution and say, let's just go get you checked out and make sure everything's okay. Anyway, it depends on how old they are, too.
Like, if they did get nodules or prurigos or anything like that.
If they have a history.
And you have to go on vocal rest, right?
Typically not. The only thing that will really put you on, you know, rest, like no phonating, is you've just had surgery or you've had a hemorrhage, and even then it's usually only 7 days. Yeah, nowadays the science is showing that people heal better doing some modified vocalization, like this draw stuff, some humming and lip buzzes. A lot of those, the semi-occluded things where your mouth is closed. Yeah. So that might be something you could try. Is you try something like that and you see how they respond. So it depends on how old they are. You know, if they're 14 and she's female and she's got kind of an airy sound, that's just because she's 14. You know, but if it's a grown, you know, if it's somebody in their mid to late 20s and you haven't seen them in 2 weeks and they come in and this is what you're getting, and they haven't been sick, but they've said they've been really practicing a lot, you go, okay. So that's one of those rule judgment calls as a teacher, and err on the side of caution. If you think anything at all is a little amiss, and it's not just that's a tired voice, but that's just a little unusual sounding, get it checked out. Okay, male student with legato with difficulties, especially on unvoiced consonants. Have him move around, that's a good one. Have him move around, so unvoiced consonants, so his unvoiced fricatives, and maybe some of the unvoiced plosives and things. It's like he overworks, you know, so he's sha, you know, well, he's like singing along, and you get, instead of,
sings more consonant
than he does vowel. Yeah, yeah. And typically on our unvoiced consonants, we have actually a higher breath pressure going than the voiced ones. So then what would we do? If he's got these legato difficulties on the unvoiced, we talk about movement. I think movement's a great idea for us.
Change it to the voice.
Exactly. Right, yeah. So if you're having, if he seems to have trouble, you know, with F's and F's and S's and sh and things like that, and the voiced versions. So, you know, instead of sure on this shiny night, you might do sure on this shining, yeah. You might use the voiced ones instead. And because there's duration of the unvoiced consonant is too long, and there's a, then he's not getting voice and going again quick enough. So have him just stay voicing with the voiced consonants. And that often, and then, you know, you can pair up. I speak from experience because this is one of my problems. You know, do some vocal leases where you're doing fa, 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 you know, where you're alternating the voiced one and the unvoiced one so that you can kind of get some crossover happening. You talked about movement. What's another thing you could do pairing with movement? It's actually volume. This might be kind of a foreign concept.
Could you have them like draw their line?
Yeah. Or, you know, a piano or a wall. Tap into another sense, tactile. So you have them moving. They're dragging their hand on a smooth surface. On the wall, you know, like, okay, draw a figure eight on the wall while we sing that phrase. Sometimes you get another sense involved. They've got kinesthetic, and then you get tactile going. If they play a violin or viola or cello, you say, you know, let's just keep the bow on the string, you know? Yeah, some analogies like that might be really good. Movement is often very helpful, and as you, as Sarah suggested, you know, using the voiced versions. Yeah, really, really helps. Female with a tight jaw, especially on back vowels.
Alternate front and back vowels. And do exercises that just kind of make the jaw moving.
Yeah, like yo, where they're kind of doing a chewing. Or, what else, Sarah, other?
I would use back engine with an L and
it could be not, not, yeah, yep. And again, that's moving their tongue and their jaw around. You can do the, you know, the manual version where you just...
little massage.
Yep, Barbara Dodger called it the molar massage. And you just kind of get in there and say, all right, we're going to just mush things around, and it isn't going to sound real pretty, but right now we just want to get your jaw a little prettier.
Would you have them move it while they sing? So like
yeah, you probably could do that. Yeah, a little bit of that. A little bit of that can be good. Is anybody going to cough drop? Or a hard candy? Something before, and then I didn't have time to get water, and then... they come out of the womb able to hum and move their mouth like that. So that's a real tapping into something really primal.
Interesting.
So I like the front and back vowel thing. I think that's a really good one. What about you guys? A suggestion to throw into that? We talked about several things.
Doing a wiggle.
The wiggle, uh-huh. We talked about that. you can do it with phrases of their music too, you know, if you see.
Oh, there's raspberries.
Raspberries also really good, if they can do them, yep.
I heard, someone told me that you should be able to lick trill and raspberry at the same time.
Oh, you can get the upper and the lower?
Mm-hmm.
I've seen people, and you're one of them, who can differentially do it. I do it one way and one way only. I've seen people, it's their lower lip, seen people, it's their upper lip. I have a friend who can do it. He can switch. It's like, how do you do that?
There's way more breath.
I can,
just use more breath pressure.
Mm-hmm.
I can do it if it's like really, 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 but then there's this bit.
Anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, whatever helps you for you, feel free. So yeah, raspberry's great. Blah, 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 tha, 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 ya, 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 yo, 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 all of those things. Those are going to be good. Female students, oops, who is a recovering belter.
A recovering belter?
Yes.
Lots of descending exercises, bringing the voice air back down.
Yep. And this is one of those that you have to really hold their hand on because they've gotten a lot of probably, you know, reinforcement for, wow, you have such a powerful voice. And now you're asking them to sound limpy for a while. And that's really hard because it's like, but I don't want to sound like this. And you've got to really say, this is, you know, stay with me here. You know, 2-3 months from now, this is going to really be smoothing things out for you. And they just have to kind of, there'll be a time where probably if they're diligent and they're actually doing what you tell them to do, the old way doesn't work and the new way doesn't work yet. And that's a really hard place as a student because you've got them accepting the fact that the old way was not helping them.
Was fine but not efficient.
Mm-hmm. Or maybe less than healthy if it was really aggressive, you know. And then, but the new way is still unfamiliar, weak, inconsistent, and then they're like, I can't perform this way at all. And that's really tough, you know, and say, well, you know, we just keep on riding the train here for another couple of weeks or, you know, a month or two, and usually you can get past that time. Yeah, but it's a hard sell for somebody who particularly if they've been getting work and stuff, and yet then they go to audition for a role that requires more mix or more legit, and they're not getting cast all of a sudden, and they're going, okay, I need to be more than just a one-trick pony. Okay. So I completely agree. Descending, you're going to have to cold turkey them. You know, it's like, okay, let's go start above, and it's going to be really wimpy, and it's going to be really airy, and just, because you're going to get, you know, their muscles are going to want to kick in. And that's where your lip trills and raspberries and things like that, you know, the mouth closed things that keep you lighter generally are going to be a real help. Male student with an overly dark, muffled sound. Thanks.
So, doing the extremes, if he's over here bringing him all the way forward and right. Back to that middle ground.
Yeah, you may have to take him farther than desirable just to get him out of the hole that he's in. Yeah.
You said maybe adding a glide.
Yeah.
To the dark bow, so like
yes.
Yo 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 or ya ya ya, bringing
yeah.
that forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a really good idea. If the person is overly dark, using the ya glide, where they're gliding through an E. And if they're overly bright, you using the wood glide, so that, you know, if they're sell, all the time, yeah, you have them do some things where they're a little more rounded. Yeah. Until you can kind of find that happy ground, the happy hunting ground. What's another thing? You guys, there's a really cool thing you can do to open someone's eyes to this. Okay, sing that one more time.
Oh.
Yes. Record and play back. Because oftentimes they think, I'm rich and powerful and whatever. And then they hear what we hear, which is muddy. And they go, does it really sound like that? And that can be a really hard sell, too, because maybe they like that.
Sounds operatic to me.
You know, they like that big, mature sound. And then you've got to say, it's got to have some brilliance to balance that. Yeah, oftentimes the playback thing, they just haven't listened to themselves as much or maybe as often. Can be very revealing. But things that front their tongue, oftentimes with the muffled sound, you also get a lot of breath pressure too. You'll get both of those things at once. Female student with a sound that is nasal and hooty. So let's try making that sound, shall we? Uh-oh. I'm trying. Okay, so nasal, you got going on. And then it's not a half hooty kind of thing going on. So where's your tongue when you do that? It's like way swallowed up. So what would cause your tongue to be way back and your palate to be down?
What would cause it?
Lots of vocalizing with NG.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Like you've been in choir, and choir director uses zing, 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 zing. Your palate never goes up. It's always down. Or zinga 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 zing 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 zing.
Huh.
Well, because it gives them good resonance. Well, it gives them sensation. But if we're talking effect on the sound that the world hears, it's maybe not the best idea. Because when we feel all that buzzy stuff, that's your energy of your voice going into your bones and getting damped out. So, yeah, that's the person who's done tons and tons of NG. And you'll hear this sound. It's a very distinctive kind of thing. And you'll hear it in a singer, and you will remember this conversation. And you will go, and you ask the student, you've been in choir a lot? Tell me some of the exercises you did in choir. And I guarantee you, you will hear, oh, well, we do like zing, da, zing, da, zing, da, zing, da. Hi. We've got a class from here till 3.
I just left my hitch ridden.
Oh, well, not so bad.
Sorry, didn't mean to interrupt.
No, no problem. So, I'll bet you all the money in my wallet that they will say, well, we've done, you know, lots of zingy, 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 zing, 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 you know. And, okay, what else did you do? Oh, well, we do, you know. And they rattle off some more that has NG in it. You know. Yeah. I mean, I will use it in small doses just to help someone feel. Because you really can feel palate down, palate up. Because you're really bringing it down. And then the release out of it. But I
so we said we'd incorporate
gotta get palate up and tongue free.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, the voiced TH, you know, or the unvoiced TH, the D. You know, you might have to do one thing at a time and do, you know, na da na da na da and kind of get their tongue forward, and then they feel,
oh, she's already nasal. Would you want to use a nasal?
Well,
to feel the alternation.
You might have to, just to get the sense of the alternation, na da na da, you know, and then say, okay, now let's do it, da na da na da, and then go, oh, okay.
Huh.
You know, you might have to do a little experimenting there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Male student who is physically very tense and rigid. What are you going to do?
You don't have
to stay.
You
don't have
to stay?
I like
it. Okay. We wrote he's got to move.
Yeah.
And
yep.
He's got move to move.
Yep.
So, like, swing his arms.
Uh-huh.
I have him stretch it out, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's one that I do is, like, you stretch as hard as you can, and then just
plop. Yep. You know, the person who is hyperfunctional, like this guy, you don't want him to turn into jello. Because it does take some energy to be, you know, sing in a big room, you know. It's an athletic kind of endeavor. So you don't want to turn him into jello. You just want to channel it a little bit better.
Maybe have him sing and rotate his shoulders.
Yeah, singing and movement, you know, so that you can get his body a little more free and let him kind of get the sense of it being a dynamic rather than a static.
I was gonna say like gorilla monkey arms.
Yeah.
Right? If you're like half hung over, you're just like.
Yeah. Yep. That's really good. Yeah. Yeah. And that might also, because he's probably also tight abdominally too. You know, it's not just gonna be upper arms and neck and stuff. It's gonna be, and so yeah, some stuff where he's really. Just get him to move around.
Good question.
Mm-hmm.
What if you have someone who's like that?
Mm-hmm.
Has scoliosis?
Oh.
And they can't do certain movements.
Right.
Right. Yeah. Well, you ask what movement they can do, what range of motion they have. Yeah, I had a girl who was born with cleft palate. And she had reconstructive surgery, and you know, we did all the things that you know, I asked her about her speech therapy, and I was like writing every speech pathologist friend I knew, and this was 1997, and I was in Portales, New Mexico, and I'm like writing Ingo Tietze, Dr. Tietze, okay, who can I talk to about, you know, that? So yeah, you get thrown something like that. You say, okay, where is the curvature? Is it high or low? It's pretty high.
He can move pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
And it, like, first glance, you wouldn't be able to tell that he's got a problem.
Yeah.
But he's in the Marines. He's built.
So
he's
already.
Tense.
Yeah.
And then he's got. Tense.
Like, because of the scoliosis?
I don't
or
know.
Because he's a
and
white
he,
man.
He,
Yeah.
Like, I've gotten him to walk around, he just kind of swing his arms, but he has tight.
Yeah. Well, you know, if he can do shoulder rolls and things like that and arm swings. I have a lady, she's in her mid-60s, and she has some neck stuff, and, you know, it's not how far they move, it's, you know, gentle and free is a whole lot more important than making these huge movements.
Yeah.
You know, if he can go this far, it's better than nothing. Yeah, and have him walk around the studio, and yeah, that's a tough one. But yeah, particularly if it's older students, and you know, they talk about back issues and neck issues and whatever, if we do any movement, I'll say, I only want you to move within your range of comfort. You know, it's more important that you move and just feel free than that we're going really, really far with the movement.
Right.
Yeah. And you might ask, you know, what kind of physical therapy stuff do they do? Okay. Yeah, so so y'all said move. Yep, absolutely. Male student, who's quite the opposite, and undersings all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Sarah, say it again.
Beat it with a stick.
There you go. When in doubt, beat him with a stick.
I said no! Go get the switch!
Yeah. Okay.
Studio switch.
So, what are we gonna do with it? Do y'all remember? I don't know. Well, probably not. When I was in elementary school, you'd go to the office.
And get paddled?
And get paddled. And you know, I mean, they had the paddle. And I mean, you know, this is like something that someone would play cricket with, you know?
Oh, yeah.
And
like
big flap, and it's got like grip. It's like
from a fraternity.
I mean, all you'd have to do is see that thing. It's like, my brother's a libertarian again. Anyway, yeah.
Not the bell.
Oh, yeah, the bell.
I
almost forgot the bell. Okay, well, let's
anyway.
Get back on the task. Sorry. That's my fault.
We talked about doing lip trails, or lip trails are like raspberries if they can do that,
mm-hmm.
to keep the air moving.
Yep. Extroverted.
Mm-hmm.
Extroverted things.
Yeah.
Yep. Absolutely right.
So do these people tend to be, like a student that undersings, does it coincide with personality? Is it most likely a little shy, introverted person?
Although.
Yeah, everybody's sort of funny.
Yeah. Yeah.
Some like break the ice.
Crazy stuff.
Sumo squats.
Yeah. Just like you have the physically tense guy.
Mm-hmm.
Have him move, have this guy move.
Okay.
Yeah. Movement is one of those great things for almost everybody.
Yeah.
If they undersing or oversing. If they oversing, you get them moving to unlock the lockup.
Yeah.
If they undersing, you know, then you have the move to feel a little more athletic about things.
What about having them like pull against you? If you're like, here, hold my hand, lean
I'm
back.
Hesitant about that, because then you're gonna get, I mean, that's a variant on the pull the piano thing.
I used to do that.
Uh-huh.
When I was a kid,
yeah.
I pulled the piano.
The problem is, you get you're swapping one kind of underdoing for another kind of tensing, you know,
okay.
You're gonna get compensatory stuff.
Right.
Because you don't want the person to press.
Mm-hmm.
You probably just want an up of their whole energy in general and commitment to singing. I have a guy in my studio right now who's a great guy, and he's very good natured about it, and in your repertoire selections can be a big part of this. You find pieces that are a little more extroverted. You have him move. You have him just constantly. Now, where was that on your, you know, like 1 to 10, you know, energy level? You know, I wouldn't say volume, but I might say energy level. You know, and usually he's like, oh yeah, that's like a 4. And I'm like, well, okay, let's try like a 6.5 or a 7.
Yeah.
Go for it a little bit.
Do we have anything like sirens and yawn sighs and?
Well, that's probably better for the person who's the overdoer.
Okay.
The yonsai thing is better for the overdoer. The underdoer, huh?
Have him yell.
I would yell, but I love the lip buzz. You know, you might have it.
Yeah.
You know, like a good vigorous buzz or a raspberry, which he's not going to push, but he will engage more on and release right into a vowel. Yeah.
What about that whole thing, I think someone told someone maybe once to like sing in front of the wall and hit the wall?
Some imagery things might be helpful. Some imagery, you know, sometimes, you know, get the person in a big room and you just keep backing up. Okay, come on, sing to me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Sparingly, that might be helpful. What I would probably do with that is, you know, get a person in a room like this and then to say, isn't it a rush to just kind of hear your voice fill the room? Let's keep doing that, you know, and just make it, you know, you got to kind of have your pants on that day, ladies, you know, and just like, yeah, this is kind of fun. Just let it rip, you know. In general, you know, there are. Let it rip. I mean,
have
as in just
on.
Let it go.
What does that mean?
Oh, have your pants on. fun. I mean, you just have to kind of be a little more, okay, you know, like one of the guys. Okay, here we go. Come on, let's do that one more time. You know, just a little more gregarious, that kind of thing.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Be a bro.
Be a bro. Yeah.
All right, Dad, what are we going to do? It's like...
No, that's... That's more of that, yeah. Sorry. Sorry. Hit him with the stick. Well,
yes.
I had a guy in my studio years ago, and I mean, he had a lovely voice. This is the guy who lost all the weight, and now he runs ultra marathons. And I mean, one day he was in there, and it was just kind of vanilla. I said, all right, hey, come with me for a minute. And he's like, okay. And so we trooped from my office, we trooped down to the front door, we walked back up the stairs, right up into my office. I said, sing. And he's like, what? I said, sing. And he's like, okay. And he kind of let loose, and I was like, yeah. I just needed him to take a deep, full breath and sing, you know? And I thought, okay, what can I do to help him physicalize this? And so I took him down the stairs and up the stairs, you know, and it was like, you want to go again? And he's like, no, I think I got it.
But,
yeah, just like get your energy up. Yeah. Well, and you'll never forget it, you know. Oftentimes, just once you get the person to kind of be able to have their own barometer of, am I really singing now or not? And you don't want them to push, but you do want them to optimize what they can do. And so, you know, I always say, you know, one is like you're asleep, you know. A 10 would be, you know, your Ozzy Osbourne, your blood, you know. So we don't go to 10, but, you know, you could sing a good 8, you know, in the climactic phrase of a song or aria, and you could sing up to an 8 and still be comfortable. You know, that's like letting it go.
Yeah.
So, because you always want to leave, you know, your principle there. You just want to sing on the interest as the same goes. Okay. Female student who pushes all of the time.
Stick.
Beat it with a stick? Okay. All right.
We said acts of ages.
Could be, yeah.
Some onset exercises.
Yeah, gentle. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. The yawn sign.
Yeah.
Could be a really good one. Ah, downward sirens and things like that. What kind of rep? You talked about rep. I mean, you talked about...
Talk about something fast.
You talked about moving stuff.
Because if it's moving, there's less opportunity for her to really get her guns out and go. Because you've got to be able to move.
You've got to get it light enough to where you can sing on through. I love... Now, and again, this is like the rigid, stiff guy. You don't want to unplug them from the energy. You just want to channel it in a better way. Sarah, I gave this exercise to you, and I was not, I'm not implying that you were pushing, because you weren't. I wanted you to sing out patterns like that that are kind of sweepy, you know, where the person can sing out, you know, arpeggiating, sweepy kind of things, where they can sing out. And yet they're moving.
Yeah.
And so let's think about rep. Well, what kinds of composers write kind of sweepy, soaring stuff?
I was thinking Quilter.
Quilter, Duke, Strauss, Brahms. Some
you give
of these.
A Buscher some Strauss.
You'd have to pick the right piece.
Yeah.
You know. You'd have to pick the right piece.
Is she a big voice who pushes, or just a pusher?
That does make a difference, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Because the big voice who pushes...
Pushes because she's got a big voice, and also because she wants to be bigger.
Yeah, she's kind of
in
love with that
big
old sound. Yeah. When you can convince someone like that that it'll be bigger if you don't have it so bottled up, that's a really, that when it's free, it's going to be enormous. Yeah, something sassy.
Yeah.
Because usually she might have that, she might like that kind of edge, but you just have to find, again, a way to channel it in the right way. Sometimes there's some folk songs that are kind of sweepy like that, you know, that can be fun. Okay, well, we need to adjourn, but what I have for you, these are some things I've kind of come with over the years. Does that make any sense? No. Things I have come up with over the years. So it's like a little, well, it's like a, okay, you're hearing this, what are some possible things you could do that won't maybe cause another problem? And here, and this is front and back, from the typewriter of Barbara Dosher, with a few additions written by me, about things that she often used.
Oh yeah, the puppy whine.
The puppy whine. Yeah, the moron look, you know.
The moron look?
Well, and the tight jaw, you know. But you can't do that with a person with scoliosis. Always get a good read on, is that person okay in their neck area? All right. They're going to have a surprise when they come in. All righty, that's all.
Clutch, return to your observations.
Yes, please.